راسه محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أخذ الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
إن شاء الله quickly about the history of Karbala and the genuine Imam Hussein عليه السلام. As you know, it all started after Muawiyah died and the news got to the people that Muawiyah died. So immediately what happened was Yazid wanted one thing, and that is to get the pledge of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. So what he did first is to tell the governor in Medina to call Imam Hussein to come and give the pledge and accept Yazid as he is the next Khalifa. So Imam Hussein got the invitation. When he got the invitation, immediately Imam Hussein said, I knew why I'm getting this invitation. Then the companion asked him, what is the reason? Imam Hussein said, I knew Muawiyah has passed away. And the reason why I'm being called is to get my pledge and to accept Yazid as his the Khalifa. However, I'm gonna go with you. But when we get there, and to the governor's palace, I want you to do something. And what is it? Is that I'm gonna enter first. When I enter, if you hear my voice is getting louder and louder, I want you to walk into it. Don't wait for anything, just walk in. They said, okay. Imam Hussein went in. Immediately as you get inside, they give him the letter, Muawiyah has passed, and then they want him to accept Yazid. Imam Hussein refused. Imam Hussein got out immediately with his companions, they left. But quickly after Imam Hussein left and came back, the narration stated that that is when he got a lot of letters from the people of Kufa that inviting Imam Hussein to come. And Imam Hussein alayhi salam sent his ambassador Muslim bin Aqil. After the Muslim bin Aqil got there and took all the pledges, he then sent a letter to Imam Hussein alayhi salam that Imam Hussein should come and the place is all ready for him. Now, that is where the starting of Imam Hussein's movement, right? All this happened when Imam Hussein was in Medina. Now, as soon as he get the letter that he should come to Kufa, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the first thing he did is to go to Masjid al-Nabawi to go and play and pay his respect and final respect to his grandfather Rasulullah. So then after that, the narration said then he decided to come to Mecca, where he wanted to come and also perform the Hajj. And by the time he got to Mecca, that is when the news also came to him that Yazid has given an order that if he did not give the pledge, then he should be killed, even if he happened to be inside the Mecca, even if he was holding the Kaaba. So Imam Hussein alayhi salam, at that time, he changed his intention from being Hajj to Umrah, so he can leave Mecca quickly, because he doesn't want to be killed inside the Kaaba, then the sanctity of Kaaba will be taken out. So immediately he left from Kaaba, from Mecca. That is when Imam Hussein took his companions, and they started their journey from Karbala, from Mecca. They were coming to Kufa. Now bear in mind, Imam Hussein, when he left Mecca, all his attention was to go to Kufa, not Karbala. Imam Hussein, when he left with the intention, I am going to Kufa. Because the invitation that came from the people of Kufa, not Karbala, right? Now what happened? When he left on his way, there were two stops, major stops. There are other stops, but there were two major stops that Imam Hussein took. The first stop is when he heard the death of Muslim bin Aqil. When he stopped and did a maktam and majlis for Muslim bin Aqil. The second stop, when Imam Hussein stopped also, was when he got closer to Kufa, right? But before he got to the Kufa, that is when he was approached by Muslim by Hur and his army. So when they met Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that is when they didn't allow Imam Hussein to go to Kufa. And that was the reason why Imam Hussein was turned, right? So when you see Imam Hussein end up going to Karbala, that was not his intention. His intention to go to Kufa. But when he was not allowed to get to Kufa, he was forced to go to Karbala. Now, when Imam Hussein got to Karbala, the narration stated when he got to Karbala, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he asked the name of the place. They said the name is Karbala. Imam Hussein, no. The name is Karbon Wabala. Karbala is a word that was formed of two words. One is Karb, meaning sorrow and grief. The other one is called Bala, mischief. Right? So he said, this is our station. This is where my grandfather told me I will be killed. So we have to station here. That is when Imam Hussein alayhi salam stopped there. Now Imam Hussein got there. When he arrived there in Karbala, the narration said the first night, the second night, Imam Hussein alayhi salam was not planning to fight them. He was planning that he was forced to stay there and he will be left to go back. But until on the 9th of Muharram, that is when letter came from Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad from Kufa, telling Imam Hussein to be attacked and fight Imam Hussein on that night. So Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that is when he started to arrange his armies, right? So Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he divided his army into three groups. One group were on his right side, one group on the left side, and one group in the middle, right? So when you look at it, the Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he had the tents of women and the children, because Imam Hussein alayhi salam had three tents. One tent is for women, one tent for his companions, and one tent for his family. That is the three tents. And the tent that he had, the first tent when you enter, was the tent of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, because he was considered as a god. So you cannot pass anyone, you cannot get to anybody until you pass Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. So he was the god, he was the security. So anybody who comes, he has to pass through Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Right? Then after that, you get to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Then there is children, then there is women. So Imam Hussein makes sure that the women are safe. Nobody could get to them unless you pass Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas and him and the men, of course. Okay? So that is what Imam Hussein alayhi salam did. And then the enemies of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, as you look, the way they did it, there is this line, the river of Furat. The first one they came, they made sure that they took this side, because they made sure that they control the water. So that way they can make sure that Imam Hussein wouldn't get anything from that water. And some narrations say they have almost 4,000 men just around the water. And that tells you how many these people were. Because some narration even mentioned that those people, when Imam Hussein even talked in his khutbah, he said, كَأَنَّهُمْ كَالْجَرَادِ. They're like bugs, you cannot count them. There's so many. But just on the river, they have like 4,000 men. And then in front of the Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they also have thousands and thousands. Some of them were in the the left side of Imam Hussein, some of them on the right side, and some of them also were behind the river, because what they did, they want to make sure that Imam Hussein alayhi salam will not get to the river, no matter what, because that is their intention. Even whatever happens, Imam Hussein have to die with that water. So there are thousands, 4,000 around the water, and thousands were in the front just to fight Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And what they do, what they used to do among the Arabs of those days, when they fight, they always pick up in the middle. And what do? They fight one by one, meaning one man from this side, one man from that side, right? They all come in the middle and they fight. If one person got killed, whether it's from this side or that side, whoever got killed, then the other side sent another man to come and fight them. And that is how they do one by one until they get to the certain point where then everybody can join the battle and join the fight and fight as the whole crowd together. Okay. So when you look at it, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the middle, that is where the center that Imam Hussein alayhi salam had, where the meeting place, where if they want to fight, they will come and fight one by one. But these were the side of the army of Yazid, which were thousands and thousands, while Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he only had 72 men and not more than that. So that is just a summary about the Karbala. If there is any questions.
I have received a question.
Yes.
If you don't mind, I'll read it to you.
Yes, please.
The question says, we know that Imam Hussein alayhi salam brought the land of Karbala from the tribe of Bani Asad. Why didn't the man of the tribe join the battle and help Imam Hussein alayhi salam?
Good question. See, there are three reasons why so many people did not fight with Imam Hussein. And one of them is the tribe of Bani Asad. Number one, a lot of tribes were already prisoned by Ibn Ziyad. A lot of tribes were prisoned by Ibn Ziyad. That is one. Number two, certain people also, they were also being scared that if you come and fight with Imam Hussein, we will bring the army of Sham. And the Jaysh al-Sham at that those days is like today when they call like United States, superpowers. They were very, very, very strong armies of that day where nobody thinks they can defeat them. So what they did, they scared people with that. That is number two. Number three, one of the reasons why some tribes were not able to join because they didn't know the importance of the message of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. So they were relaxed, right? That is why after the Karbala, after the tragedy of Karbala, when you go back to the history, you see a lot of revolution started. We have what we call Thawrat al-Mukhtar. Then we have Thawrat al-Madina. Then Thawrat al-Tawabin, right? The revolution started coming one after the other. One of them is called the Tawabin, those who repented. Because they regret that they should have supported Imam Hussein, which they did not. The people of Medina, they also came. So the reason why they didn't support them, one of the reasons some of them were in prison, some of them also didn't understand the importance of the message of Imam Hussein. But until Imam Hussein got killed, they realized and they asked for forgiveness after that. Yes.
Just a question, I guess, to the people who created this model. Where how did you know where to place things, and like where is the references? Like we know about the river, that's very clear. But geographically, was this sort of based on a reference or?
Basically, what we did was we did a lot of homework looking into historical maps of where everything was. Obviously, this structure doesn't justify where everything geographically is right now, but we took the help of our resident, Molana, who gave us all the points where everything happened, and that's how it went. Any other questions?
Just one question, Shahna.
Yes.
This is one thing that is very important that I think we need to sort of reflect upon. Because if you see, like, as an example, as a scholar, was in the army of Yusufi in the Mu'awi and shifted to Imam Hussein. And however, he has perfect similarity with Omar ibn al-Has. What is the actual difference that he had or made? Need him to take this step to move forward with the arm of Imam Hussein alayhi salam.
Yes, Sahur, he has a lot of reason why he chose to go with Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Number one, the historians, they say Hur ibn Yazid al-Rayahi, when he first was with Ibn Ziyad, he was not being told the truth. What he was told is, we don't want to kill Imam Hussein. What we want is to prevent him from coming to Kufa. That's it. Because they think in their mind, if Imam Hussein comes to Kufa, everything will be destroyed. So they don't want that. So they just want to keep him away. So the reason why they send Hur is to go and distract Imam Hussein not to come to Kufa. That was the reason. So that's the intention that he went there for. But when he went there, that was all he wanted to do to make sure Imam Hussein doesn't come to Karbala, that doesn't come to Kufa. And that's what he did, trying to divert Imam Hussein all the way to Karbala. Now, he went there, they sat there, they were talking the first night, the second night, all those times he was thinking that they just want to, you know, give Imam Hussein hard time and that's it. Until the night when the letter came from Ibn Ziyad telling them to attack Imam Hussein, that was when he was saying, are you really going to fight this man? That's not what we agreed before. Then Umar bin Sa'd said to him, yes, نُقَاتِلُهُ قِتَالًا أَيْسَرُهَا تَطِيرُ فِي الرُّوسِ وَالْأَيْدِ. The least that will happen, the heads will be flying in this battle, the hands will be flying on this land. So that is exactly what we're planning to do. That is when he started to realize, no, that is not what I signed for. Yes.
But on the perspective of Amr, also in the same time, what also action took him to be so deeply to take sort of a type of a revenge or do such a thing? Isn't it true also there was a competition between the both?
Yes.
Or who's going to take sort of the lead or the throne?
Right. You know, for them, what did push them really, when you look, is mainly about hubb al-dunya. Hubb al-dunya, the love of position and money. That is exactly what pushed Shimmer and Umar bin Sa'd. Because when you go back to the history, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they talked to Umar bin Sa'd. And he told him, don't go with those people. Come with me. I'll give you anything you want. You know, first of all, the most point is, I will guarantee you heaven. Because my father is Imam Ali, my mother is Zahra, my grandfather is Rasulullah, I can guarantee heaven. Then he said, yes, I know you have heaven, but that is for future. But Ibn Ziyad is telling me I will be the master of Jarjan and Ray, which is Iran, and that is much closer. And I love that, because you're talking about future and he's talking about current. So I prefer something that is current. So Hubb al-Dunya, that was the reason why he went. And then when you come to Shimr, also because he was promised about money and wealth. And that's why after they killed Imam Hussein, when he went to Sham, as he was entering the palace of Yazid, he says, إِمْلَ أَرْكَابِي فَضَّةً أَوْ ذَهَبًا فَإِنِّي قَتَلْتُ خَيْرَ النَّاسِ أُمَّنْ وَأَبًا. He said, fill my jar, because he was carrying a jar with him. He said, fill this jar with gold and diamond that I was promised, because I have killed the best man who happened to have the best parents. Then, Yazid then was so angry. He said, إذا علمت أنه خير الناس أما وأبا لما قتلت. If you know he has the best parents, why did he kill him? Now listen to his answer. Money, gold. Then he says, أخرج فلا جائزة لك. He said, get out, you're not getting anything from me. Okay, so the difference is that those people, they were influenced by حب الدنيا. And that is why they couldn't resist. And they have to kill Imam Hussein. That's despite the fact that they knew the truth.
But if we took like a comparison, let's say, because also the same thing happened with Imam Ali Salam and Safin, and then also there is the perspective of Karbala. What is the difference of the army of Imam Ali and Imam Hussein? And and do people that fought with Imam Hussein Ali Salam, the Ansar of Imam Hussein, what things had particularly in their being, something that was different? If we could reflect upon that.
Absolutely. You know, first of all, when you look at the companions of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, I can tell you that there is something we call tawfiq ilahi. Tawfiq ilahi, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has helped them. They have a divine help from within, really. Because that's why when you go to Imam Hussein, when he talks about his companions, he says, Inni la a'lamu ashaban abar wa awsal min ashabi. He said, I don't know of any companions who are very loyal, dedicated, like these companions of mine. Right? So they have some kind of divine help. And I can give you one example of those companions. There are many of them. Each one of them have the divine help from different angles. For example, like Zuhair. You know, when you go to the history, they say Zuhair, he grew up with Imam Hussein. They grew up together. They used to play together. But one day the Prophet made dua for him. If the Prophet saw him, they were playing, he came and picked him up and hold his hand and then put his hand on the chest of Zuhair and he made dua and he said, Allahumma rizuku shahadata ma waladi al-Husayn. You know, Allah gave him, guarantee him the heaven, the shahada, martyrdom with my son Hussein. So that is why when Imam Hussein wanted to leave Karbala, first of all, Zuhair didn't want to go. But later on, when Imam Hussein sent a messenger and he came and he talked to him, he said, that's it, I made my wish, I'll come with you. So you can see that there is a divine help from them, for them. That is one. And number two, some of them also, they were not into dunya like most of the people of those days. A lot of people of that time, they were more into money, position, power. Where the companions of Imam Hussein, they were not into that. And one of them, you can see, is his son, Ali al-Akbar. When he spoke, he was telling them, no, what is this dunya? Like, for example, when Imam Hussein was walking to Karbala on their way, when they stopped to spend the night, and he woke up and he was saying, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. He says, I heard you saying a lot of Inna lillahi. Is there any reason? Then Imam Hussein said, yes, I see we are approaching our death. His response was, أَوَلَسْنَا عَلَى الْحَقِّ Are we on the right? He said, yes. He said, إِذَنْ لَا نُبَالِي أَوَقَعْنَا عَلَى الْمَوْتِ أَمْ وَقَعَ الْمَوْتُ عَلَيْهِ Then don't bother if we rush to death, if we run to death, or the death run to us. Doesn't matter. So you have those companions who didn't have anything to do with dunya compared to other people who have more of everything of this dunya. So that is one thing about Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Number three, also Imam Hussein's companions, a lot of them, they already heard about Karbala, that they will be coming, Imam Hussein will be killed. So they already knew that this day is coming. So they were prepared. Versus the companions of Imam Ali alayhi salam, most of them, they didn't know the truth. You know, there were some companions of Imam Ali in Siffin, those who were not clear about exactly whether they should be with Imam Ali or they should be with Muawiyah. So some of them, they have to wait and wait until some of the companions get killed, then they can tell the truth. Like some of them, they were waiting for Ammar to be killed. Because the Prophet says, Ya Ammar, sataqtuluka al-fi'atul baghiya. So Ammar was with Imam Ali alayhi salam, but they were not sure what will happen. So until Ammar was killed, then they say, then these Muawiyah and his companions are the bad guys. Because that was what the Prophet said. So let's join with Imam Ali alayhi salam. So a lot of people of that time of Imam Ali, they were not clear. That is why Imam Ali alayhi salam, he says at that time, when people came and asked him, he says, because a lot of people were not able to tell the truth at that time.
Now, this is, could you say also that the companion of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they had the free will also in the same time. There was no mesh that was holding them from defending Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And if this is the case, how could we reflect upon the modern world if this incident, tragedy that happened in humanity, how could we bring it into our era of time?
Yeah. Of course, you know, we can look at it that way, because one main thing that I can see, and a lot of authors also elaborate on that during the time of Imam Hassan, Imam Ali started coming to Imam Hassan, coming to Imam Hussein, really people were more into dunya a lot. And that is why Imam Hassan was not able to fight Muawiyah. Why? Because the majority of the people were bought with money. Muawiyah used to send money at night, you know, buying the companions of Imam Hassan alayhi salam. The next day, Imam Hassan alayhi salam organized, they will go and fight. The next day, the general will come and say, no, I won't be able to make it, I'm sorry. Then he has to change the plans. The next day, he chose somebody, they were bought with money. So Imam Hussein finally had to give up. Because people were not pure in their faith and their deen as well. While Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they did have that. Right? So that is number one. Number two also, yes, a lot of the companions of Imam Hussein who went with them, they have a free will. Right? But this free will comes with what? Knowing your aqidah. A lot of the people, companions of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they have their aqidah taken care of. You know, they understood who was the Imam of their time. You know, that is very important. Our time today, it doesn't matter, I'm praying, I'm fasting. If I don't know the Imam of my time, that is a big problem. And the companions of Imam Hussein, they were able to locate that this is our Imam, and we're supposed to do anything to protect him. And that is why when you go back to the history, even Imam Hussein was telling them, leave. Right? They said, no, we're not going to leave. What would we leave our Imam? What would be our answer to our master? So they recognized the Imam of their time. Our people, today, our responsibility is to get to know our Imam. And when I say to know our Imam, I don't mean to know, oh, my Imam is 12 Imam, Imam al-Hujjah. No, everybody knows that. You can teach your children like that. I mean more to that, to know what is my responsibility towards my Imam. What is it my Imam is expecting from me as a follower? What is it that I could do to serve my Imam? That is what we need to know. because they are a mutual responsibility. Ours, our responsibility as a followers towards our Imam, and then the responsibility of Imam towards us. We don't need to tell Imam what is his responsibility, but we need to know our responsibilities towards Imam. And that is what that time of Imam Hussein, the people understood, and today that's what we need to understand about the, our Imam as well.
Any other questions, comments?
I have a comment. I want us to recite a large salawat and the Fatiha for those who have put this time to make this happen so we can come and learn from this. So please, let's recite one salawat for them. May Allah bless them for all this effort that they have put to make this happen, inshallah. Salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Thank you.